That's wonderful, Julie. Thank you so much for those words. Powerful, really, really impressive. We touched a little bit on this withdrawal agreement. And Anne talked, she used the word arrest. And when you get arrested, not that I have any experience of this, I'm told they use these things called handcuffs. And it's often quite difficult to really understand exactly why this withdrawal agreement is so bad. So I thought we'd try and sort of give a little bit of a graphical image. A picture tells a thousand words. And if we sign this terrible withdrawal agreement, we will be handcuffed to the European Union forever, for many, many years to come. We'll be trapped. If you're handcuffed, where are you taken? Well, you're taken to a prison. I love the sound effects. And what P stands for is that we would be paying 39 billion quid for nothing in return except the right for a chat. It doesn't guarantee a trade deal, no. Just the right for a chat. R. R stands for being ruled by the European Court of Justice for many, many years to come, with no say, no voice. So you can see what's happening. I stands for inside the customs union. That means we can't do trade deals. We can't do trade deals, we can't reduce tariffs, we can't reduce prices for consumers, and we're still in the single market. So you see what's happening here, ladies and gentlemen. It's starting to feel a little bit restricted. It's a bit cozy. And we haven't even finished yet. S. S stands for suffering, that we would continue to be plundered and the pillage of our fishing waters around our coastal communities that we want back. They're our waters and we want them back. So, you can see what's going on. We're handcuffed and we're closed in. And then they're going to order us around. They're going to order that we accept their rules and regulations with no say, no voice, even on matters of defense. They would tell us what we've got to do with our military. They'll tell us what we've got to do with foreign policy. And Nigel will talk about the Iranian tanker saga a bit later. So you can see what's happening here, ladies and gentlemen. I'm trapped. I'm locked in. So to end, ladies and gentlemen, N means that is not Brexit. We are trapped in a prison, still handcuffed to the European Union. Is that what you want?
No!
Are you sure you don't want that?
No!
Just checking you're still awake. No, we do not want that. I'm very clear what we want. We want to break free of all of that. We want to get rid of the handcuffs. We want to be a free, sovereign nation, independent, able to do what we want. Bars, let's get rid of the wretched things. We don't want bars, we don't want handcuffs, we want our freedom. Free to buy our British products when we want to. Free to protect our crucial strategic industries like steel, like defense, like our railways. These are the freedoms that we need. Free to govern our country as we see fit in a proper, fair, and free democracy. And there is no one who has fought more for our freedom, for democracy, and independence over the last 25 years than our next speaker. Because we all know that without Nigel, there would have been no referendum. We all know that without Nigel, there would have been no Brexit. And without Nigel, there wouldn't be the Brexit Party. And without the Brexit Party, heaven forbid, Theresa May would still be Prime Minister. Oh. But thank heavens Before we welcome Nigel to the stage, let's just see him in action on the video.
It's extraordinary to think that back in March of this year, all seemed lost from a Brexit perspective. We had a Labour and Conservative Party, both of whom were happy not to take us out of the European Union. And I felt that something absolutely fundamental had broken. Trust in politics, trust in our entire political system, and that is why I founded the Brexit Party, to restore that faith. What we've done already is we have completely reset the political agenda in this country, so much so that a clean break Brexit on the 31st of October is now by far the most popular option in this country.
Please welcome to the stage, Nigel Farage.
Hello, Newport! Great to be back in Wales. I remember the last time I was here, the party had just been formed. We were heading into a European election, and I think by topping the polls as convincingly as we did here in Wales in these European elections, we have now put fear in the hearts of the other people in the valleys of South Wales, and I'm very pleased about that. Never before has a brand new political movement, in the space of less than 6 weeks, gone from nothing to winning. We won across the country, but we won here in Wales absolutely convincingly. And I can't really think of a part of the United Kingdom that is now less represented than Wales. There are 40 members of parliament that Wales sends to Westminster. 39 of them have either voted to stop us leaving on the 31st of October with a clean break Brexit, or voted for Mrs. May's dreadful new European treaty. Only one out of 40 MPs in Wales, David Jones, have stood up for what the people of Wales voted for so clearly, so decisively. 75% of Welsh councils voted to leave, and just one MP has been prepared to stand up. Just one. And that one MP who's had the guts to stand up for you is retiring at the next general election. So you might think you've got nobody to stand up for you. You might think you've got nobody to vote for. Well, with me today on the stage are the men and women who will stand for the Brexit Party at the next general election. Give them a hand. And they're going to be needed, because of course most of these seats, particularly in the South, have been held by the Labour Party for 100 years or more. Indeed, in many ways South Wales was the birth of the Labour Party, but it's a very, very different Labour Party today than the one that for much of that period has represented the voters in South Wales. It is now a party of Islington and not Isloin. It doesn't represent you. And the complete contempt with which they treat now the Labour Party Leave voters is astonishing. You know, the North London intelligentsia that run Labour, the Keir Starmer types, the Emily Thornberrys. I know James talked about it, but it's worth running through again, isn't it, really? Did you see Emily Thornberry on Question Time the other week? Yes. Poor old Richard had to sit next to her for an hour. I mean, it must have been agony. And there she was, espousing her view as to what the Labour Party should do. Win the election. Go to Brussels. Renegotiate a new deal. Put it to the people in a referendum. And then vote against it. I mean, you couldn't make this stuff up, could you? And Corbyn himself, who this week has confirmed that the second referendum would be a choice of Remain or a new deal based on membership of a customs union and a single market. Corbyn wants to offer you the choice of Remain versus Remain. Can you think of a bigger insult? And can you imagine the way that so many of your MPs have behaved in Westminster, the shenanigans we've seen over the course of the last few weeks, aided and abetted by that ghastly little man called Burko. But they literally have set out to subvert the democratic process. Who would have thought that in all the countries of the world, the one that was known as the Mother of Parliaments should have behaved the way that it's done? And you see them on the television, they look so smug, complacent, pleased with themselves at all they've done. And I think that disconnect between Westminster and you here in Wales has got a whole lot wider in the course of the last couple of weeks. They don't seem to understand that. So let's make this message very, very clear in Labour-dominated Wales. When the next election comes, and there will be an election, although at the moment, the Labour Party's job has been to stop us leaving and to stop us having a general election. It's extraordinary, isn't it? Quite extraordinary. It's so awful. But there will be an election at some point. Probably in November, I don't know. It could be later. But every Leave voter here in Wales needs to understand the Labour Party have turned their backs on them. The Labour Party have betrayed them, and the Labour Party are not worthy of their vote at that election. Now, we did, I think, one of the remarkable things that we did with the European elections, with the birth of a party that is now, I think, are we 25 weeks old this week? 23. Oh, gosh, I'm running ahead of myself. But one of the remarkable things we did, well, of course, one of the effects was we helped Mrs. May on her way out of Downing Street and not before time. And I don't think Boris would have even got through to the last two, let alone won the leadership, had it not been for the power of our vote and the fear within Conservative ranks. So let's be fair to Boris. For the last few weeks, he did inject some energy and optimism into the job. I mean, it would have been quite difficult not to have done, given what had gone before. But he did do that. And it was all sounding really rather heroic, wasn't it? You know, we're going to leave on the 31st of October, do or die. We even heard further references to rather being dead in a ditch. And it all sounded very, very heroic. But I'm sorry to say that things have taken a very different turn. And we saw that this week in Strasbourg, because the 29 of us,
including the two from Wales. The 29 of us were there in Strasbourg this week in the European Chamber. You might have read one or two press reports about that. Every time any speaker got up and tried to condemn the United Kingdom, condemn the Brexit result, or suggest that we should be made to vote again, you can bet your life the Brexit Party MEPs were in full voice on your behalf. Don't worry about that. Because, I don't know about you, but we've just about had enough of our nation being talked down to and humiliated by other EU and European leaders. I mean, who did that little guy in Luxembourg think he was last week? Unbelievable. And it wouldn't have mattered whether it was Boris Johnson or Jeremy Corbyn as Prime Minister. This was our Prime Minister, who, when they go abroad, represents us. And to be put in front of that baying mob with that little pipsqueak of a Prime Minister. I called him a pipsqueak in the European Parliament. I thought it was really quite polite by my standards, really. But amusingly, the interpreters had great trouble putting that into Greek. They couldn't quite fathom it. So we were very united as a party, very united as a group there this week. But what we saw, it wasn't the insults and the abuse of people like Verhofstadt, who is... And by the way, we do need to recognize something, that in a civilized democracy, we can respect the fact people have different points of view and like them as human beings, all right? That's very, very important. Very, very important. However, this does not apply to Guy Verhofstadt. Who is perfectly vile at all times. But what was interesting wasn't so much the theatre on the back benches. What was interesting was what came from the front of the chamber. What was interesting was what Juncker had to say. What was interesting is what Barnier had to say. There was a very different tone to anything I've seen since the referendum. There was no knocking or mocking of Boris Johnson, no condemnation from those two of the Brexit result, just a little bit of regret. And on the backstop, which of course up until now had been this great article of faith, Juncker said, "I have no emotional attachment to the backstop." Now, he said that in the morning. Well, I wouldn't want to be a hypocrite on this score now, would I? But later on that evening, he said, "I have no erotic attachment to the backstop." Actually, whatever the politics, I do find Juncker rather fun, and I quite like him, really. But you can see what's happening here, can't you? You can see what's happening here. Boris Johnson, when he talked about leaving with what he calls no deal, and by the way, I don't want any of you ever, particularly you lot, ever to talk about no deal. It's not no deal. It's a clean break Brexit, all right? It's positive. It's good. And for everything we're told from Operation Yellowhammer and everything else, the one other thing I saw this week in Brussels and Strasbourg that struck me was the absolute horror they have got of the idea of a clean break Brexit. Because if we break free, we are able to become, outside of their rule book, more competitive than the rest of the European Union. And there is a wall of global money. out there waiting to invest in a Britain that is freed of these rules. It'll be good for jobs, it'll be good for investment, it'll be good for South Wales, it'll be good for the rest of the United Kingdom. So no more defensive language about no deal. It's a clean break and a better future. That is what we're fighting for. Thank you. So let's be clear. Let's be clear. If Boris Johnson thinks that by simply picking up Mrs. May's, oh, and by the way, they call it Mrs. May's deal. Well, she didn't write it, did she? I said who wrote it. Barnier wrote it with Mrs. Merkel looking over his shoulder. And it's not an agreement, it's not a deal, it is a new European treaty. That is what it is, binding in international law, and for reasons you've heard already, almost impossible for us to break out of unless the other side wants to let us go free, which we know already is not what they are ever going to do. So let's make sure people understand that it is a new treaty. It would be a complete betrayal of the Brexit vote from the very beginning. From the Bloomberg speech, when Cameron announced the referendum that he would give us, he said the choice will be membership of the Union or we will leave. And he wanted to frighten us, you see. He wanted to make us think, oh dear, we best not be too naughty. Or we'll leave all together. Well, all together now. What's wrong with that? We want to leave, don't we? We want a clean break Brexit. And they told us all the way through we'd leave the single market, we'd leave the customs union. They have, as Anne brilliantly pointed out earlier, tried to change the meaning of the word leave. They think we didn't know what we voted for, but we did know what we voted for. We voted to be outside the institutions of the European Union. We voted to be self-governing. We voted to be free. We voted to overturn nearly 50 years of lies. And that's what we've had. That's what we've had. Those of you in this room who were old enough to vote back in 1975 know that we were told it was about trade. We were told it was about friendship. We were told it was about cooperation with our European neighbours. And people voted for that. And do you know something? People would vote for that today. I'd vote for that today. I want us to be friends with our European neighbours. Of course I do. But I view what has been built up through stealth in Brussels, the unaccountable power at the centre within the European Commission. I view their ambitions for an army. I view their growth of a foreign policy, their continued expansion, their absolute determination to build a new European empire and to crush and to snuff out nation-state democracy. I don't think this is just bad for us. I think it's bad for the whole of the rest of Europe too. I really do. I really genuinely do. In some ways, I guess the picture looks bleak. The Liberal Democrats are now all for simply revoking Article 50. In fact, Joe Swinson tells us it was a terrible mistake to have the referendum, despite the fact she campaigned for a referendum at the time, but no one seems to care. Plaid also now wants simply to revoke Article 50. Labour is now a second referendum Remain party, and we're on the verge, I'm afraid, despite all the promises, of being let down by the Conservatives yet again. Yet again. So it may look bleak, but actually it isn't. Despite the wall of propaganda, the nonsense of Yellowhammer, the threat that we could run out of medicines, of food, I mean, I don't know whether Juncker's got a fleet of U-boats now he's going to sink all our vessels with. I just don't know. You know, and when the president of the port of Calais and the boss of the port of Dover tell you they're 100% ready for Brexit in whatever form it comes, I suggest we listen to them and not the overpaid pen pushers in Whitehall who are not doing a neutral job. And once Brexit's done, we'll take the knife to them. All right? Had enough of all of it. Had enough of all of it. But however tough or bleak it may look, be reassured by this. The public aren't fools, and they're not being fooled. And the majority now who favour a clean break Brexit over an extension and a second referendum is a commanding 15 to 20 points in the lead. Our side is winning. We're getting bigger. We're getting stronger. And none of this would or could have happened if it wasn't for the birth of the Brexit Party, if it wasn't for the ability of this organisation to turn people's anger into hope. And I'm proud of the people that I've managed to gather around me in the space of these 23 weeks. I'm proud as we go touring around the country. This is one of 10 meetings that we're doing, our sort of rolling conference tour. I'm proud of all of you for turning out. I'm proud of all of those people who paid £25 online and helped us raise £3 million quickly, something that no political party online has ever done before. I'm proud of all of our collective efforts, but understand, we've got bigger, harder battles to fight in the future, but with your support and your help and these people, I think the one message we can send out from Newport today is that we are ready! Thank you.